Good evening all. Welcome to DAMS MedMeet International UG Conference Lecture Series. We are fortunate to have with us today Dr. Srijit R., Associate Professor, Department of General Medicine, Government Medical College, Kozhikode. Welcome, sir. We are grateful to you, sir, for spending your time here with us. Today's lecture will be on the basics of ECG, a tricky topic for all of us undergraduate students. We will begin with the lecture now. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Arya. So today's topic, we'll be dealing with basics of ECG. As you know, ECG will be a difficult topic for most of the undergraduates as they are not have any direct experience with reading ECGs or interpreting ECGs. They will be only learning some basics in textbooks. But that is totally different when you interpret an ECG as a bedside and correlate clinically what is the ECG finding and the clinical condition and make a diagnosis and move on. Many times this requires, you may think that this may require too much intellect or too much things to be learned from ECG, but as a, only knowing the basics of ECG, it's by itself, you can move towards a basic diagnosis from ECG. Many times you will not get much time to interpret. Sometimes the patient may be coming and the patient may be having something like an arrhythmia and you will have to detect it immediately even from the monitor itself and you have to act immediately. Otherwise, sometimes the patient may die. For example, it may be a dangerous arrhythmia like ventricular fibrillation. So there is no time. So it is mandatory that every medical person should have an idea of dangerous arrhythmias rather than reading the basics of ECG. But they should, at a glance, they should identify dangerous arrhythmia so that they can save a life. But otherwise, whenever you see an ECG, when you see a patient's ECG, always you have to read the ECG in a stepwise, orderly manner. Otherwise, you are going to miss several diagnoses. So that is a problem. Jumping into a certain finding is going to miss you several other important things which is given in the ECG. So with this, we will start on the basics of ECG. So electrocardiogram is the transthoracic interpretation of the electrical activity of the heart, as you all know. And before going to the details of ECG, you should know the basics about the conducting system of the heart. As you know, the electrical activity of the heart starts from the SA node and spreads through the internodal pathways into the AV node, where it depolarizes the atrium. Then in the AV node, there is an AV nodal delay followed by a bundle of His and the bundle branches. The bundle branches are mainly left bundle branch and the right bundle branch. The left bundle branch subdivides into anterior and posterior divisions. And the right bundle branch goes without division. And then they finally end up in Purkinje fibers inside the myocardium and spreads the depolarization throughout the heart. So this is the, in summary, what is the conducting system of the heart. And based on this, you are finding several changes in the ECG. That's the normal waves of the ECG are based on how the depolarization starts from the SA node and spreads through this conducting system into the heart. So you can see that as the depolarization spreads through the conducting pathway, it produces several waves in the ECG. So you can see first you have a P wave, then it is followed by a small isoelectric segment, which is called the PR segment. Then you have a small Q wave, followed by a tall R wave, positive wave called R wave, and a negative wave called S wave. Then you have an isoelectric segment called ST segment, and followed by another wave called T wave. And occasionally you may see another small wave called U wave, which is not always present, and sometimes it may be pathological also. So this is PQRST. So this is the normal different waves you can see in a normal ECG. So again, coming back, the P wave denotes atrial depolarization. And then you have a PR segment, which is an isoelectric segment. And the P wave and the PR segment together is comprising the PR interval. So interval means it contains a wave as well as a segment. Segment means it is an isoelectric segment. Okay. Then you have the QRS, that is a ventricular depolarization. And then you have the ST segment. Then you have the T wave. Okay. And if from the beginning of the QRS to the end of T wave is called the QT interval. Okay. So this is the ST segment, this is the T wave, and QRS plus ST segment plus T wave is called the QT interval. So this is how the normal waves and the intervals and the segments in a normal PQRST of the ECG. Now, electrocardiograph is the machine and electrocardiogram is the record of that activity. So don't confuse between these two. And before taking an ECG, you have to have proper skin preparation. Suppose the patient is having a hairy chest. If you place on ECG leads without shaving, it may not be properly sticking on. You may get a false recording, or you may get so many errors or artifacts. So it is mandatory that you just have a proper skin preparation, placement of the limb electrodes in the correct place, and placement of the chest electrodes. As you know, there are limb leads as well as chest leads for an ECG. So you have to place it correctly to get an ECG recording. So after placing these limb leads, and in this picture, you can see only the chest leads are kept, and the limb leads are kept in the two arms, right arm, left arm, and one in the left lower limb. Okay. So when these leads are properly placed, you can, and the patient is not moving, then you take the machine, you can press the button and the ECG will come out as a different leads. Now, the limb leads are basically bipolar leads. That's the lead one, lead two, and lead three are the bipolar leads. And then you have the augmented leads called AVR, AVL, and AVF. So these are the basic limb leads. The augmented leads you cannot see actually. It is actually calculated by the machine. By the bipolar leads only you are placing as manually you are placing in the patient. Now, before going into the basics actually of the leads, you have to know what is the Einthoven's triangle, which you might have studied in the physiology and you very well might have forgotten by now. So you can see the lead one is placed between the right arm and the left arm. Okay, the positive is on this side. Then the lead two is placed between the right arm and the left limb. Okay, so this is the lead two. Again, positive on this side. And the lead three is between the left arm and the left limb. So this is the lead three. So these three leads, when it is placed properly, this forms a triangle, and the center of it is this. And the AVR and the AVL and the AVF actually divides this triangle into equal halves. So let us see what is the basis of this electrical axis. So when you place the lead one, this is the lead one, as I have mentioned, this comes at the 0 degree. Then the lead two is kept at the 60 degree, that's plus 60 degree, and lead three at plus 120 degree. And you have to understand the fact that the part below is the positive area, and the part above this area is called the negative area. So this is 0 degree. If this is plus 60 degree, this is minus 60 degree. And this is plus 120, this is minus 120, like that. So this part is, this half is the plus positive half, and this half is the negative half. So when you are using the limb leads alone to calculate the axis of the heart, the problem is that you can either calculate as 0 degree or 60 degree or 120 degree. So you need more leads. So this is why you are introducing the AVR, AVL, and AVF. So when you place AVR, AVL, and AVF, it actually splits this each of this into half. So the AVL is placed at minus 30. Remember that I told that the above part is this, up to this half of the part is minus degree, and this half is the plus degree. So lead one is 0, AVL is minus 30 degree, then the AVF is downward, so it comes as plus 90 degree, and AVR is on the opposite side, so it's minus 150 degree. So these are the, when you split up using the augmented leads. So I will show you another diagram which actually shows what you just want to assess the electrical axis. So removing all other leads. So this is the one you have to identify. The lead one is 0 degree. AVL is minus 30 degree. This usually compresses the lateral wall of the heart. Then you have the lead 2 at 60 degree. AVF at 90 degree plus, these are all plus, and lead 3 at 120 degree. AVR is a lead that is standing towards the negative side and the degree is minus 150 degree. So these are the basic degrees of each of the electrical axis of the heart. So what is its clinical implication and how to calculate the axis of the heart, ECG, I will tell you in a later slide. Now, these are the, after the limb leads, we'll be moving into the chest leads. And the chest leads, you can see there is, it is named as from V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. These are the common leads. You can see the V1 is placed on the right side. V2 is placed on the left side, on the opposite sides of the sternum. Then you have the V3 is placed in between the V2 and V4. V4 corresponds to the apex of the heart. Then the V5 anterior axillary line and the V6 mid axillary line. So this is the normally placed chest leads of the ECG. Now, sometimes to assess the right side of the heart, you can utilize another extra leads called V3R and V4R, which are placed corresponding to the V3, the right side. If you place a lead here, that is called the V3R. And if you place a lead here corresponding to the V4 on the right side, it's called the V4R. So this is utilized especially to diagnose conditions like myocardial infarction affecting the right side of the heart or right ventricular myocardial infarction. You may have to use such leads. So these are the common chest leads and the limb leads. Now, this is what I was telling. Whenever there is a change in the anterior, that is the V1, V2, V3, V4, this is the anterior wall. This corresponds to the anterior wall of the heart. So any pathology affecting that, for example, a myocardial infarction, if it is changes are in V1, V2, V3, V4, that indicates it's an anterior wall change. Next, if you have a V5, V6, which is, you can see from this diagram, it is placed laterally, V5, V6. Similarly, the lead one and AVL. Lead one and AVL is also lateral. So if you have a V4 to V6 with the lead one and AVL involvement, you call it as an anterolateral or extensive anterior wall involvement. And from this diagram, the previous diagram, you can identify that the lead 2, 3 and the AVF are downwards, positioned downwards. Okay. So you can, this is plus 60, plus 90 and plus 120. This is directed downwards. So this comprises the inferior wall. Okay. So whenever you have changes in lead 2, 3 and AVF, this changes denotes a change in the inferior wall of the heart. While as you can see from this diagram, the lead 1 and AVL is the lateral wall of the heart. Okay, now moving on. So before reading the ECG, you should know what is the calibration, normal calibration of the ECG. The ECG paper moves at a speed of about 25 millimeter per second. The height. Okay, so you have, when you take an ECG, you have a one small square. This is called the one small square. Okay, you can see that is one small square. And there is something called the big square. So that is a big square. So you can see from this diagram, this is the small square and this is the big square. In the x-axis, you have the time and the y-axis, you have the voltage. So as the time moves, the ECG paper goes on moving at a speed of 25 millimeter per second. And this is the height. So the 1 centimeter, this is 1 centimeter. 10 small squares comprises 1 centimeter. Okay. So each one of the small square is 0.1. Okay. So it is corresponds to 0.1 millivolt. So each small square corresponds to 0.1 millivolt. And each of the large comprises of 5 millivolt. Okay. If you have a large square that is comprising of 0.5 millivolt. So this is 0.1 millivolt and this is 0.5 millivolt. Okay. 0.1 into 5. And on the x-axis, each of the small square is 0.04 seconds. Each of the small square is 0.04 seconds, or otherwise you can call it as 40 milliseconds. And each of this x-axis, the big square is comprising of 0.04 into 5, that is 0.2 seconds. Okay. So this is the basic dimension of a small square and a large square in an ECG. I will tell you once more. A small square, the x-axis is 0.04 seconds, and the y-axis is 0.1 millivolt. And the big square, the x-axis is 0.2 seconds and the y-axis is 0.5 millivolt. So this is the normal dimensions of a small square and a big square in an ECG. You have to understand this very well because we will be calculating so many things based on this small square and big square. Now, this is how a normal 12-lead ECG will look like. So it can be like coming like a sheet like this, or it may be coming as a lengthy paper which shows all these leads in a lengthwise manner. So you can see in this lead, you can see the lead one is written here. Then you have the lead two, lead three. Then you have the augmented leads AVR, AVL, and AVF. Then you have the chest leads V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, and V6. So this is how a 12-lead ECG will span out in front of you. So the thing is that now you have to identify what are the abnormalities or what are the changes, anything abnormal that you have to find out in a stepwise manner. So before going to the proper ECG analysis, you have to make sure that there are no errors in that ECG. So how do you, sometimes the accidentally the lead can be misplaced. For example, the lead which should be kept in the leg might have been accidentally kept in the arm, like that. So to identify this, the important point is that you can see this ECG, look at the AVR. As I already told, the vector AVR is directed towards minus 150 degree. So always all waves in the AVR will be negative. The P wave will be negative, QRS will be negative, and the T wave will be also. So everything is inverted downwards. That is because the AVR is standing at a minus degree and the normal electrical lead picks up in the opposite direction. So all waves in the AVR is usually a negative. And the lead one will be usually positive. So these are the normal findings in an ECG. Lead one will be usually positive. All waves in the AVR will be negative. And there is progressively the QRS will be of the R wave is small here. Then the R wave becomes much more bigger in V3. Then V4, V5, V6. As the leads passes, the R wave becomes more taller and taller. These are the usual findings you get in a ECG. So whenever check, the AVR is all negative. And so if it is not that, then that means there is some limb reversal or lead reversal has happened. Limb lead reversal has happened. So make sure that if you interpret certain ECG, you may land up in a wrong assumption. So make sure that there is no limb lead reversal. Now the chest leads, as I was talking previously, the R wave, there's something called R wave progression. So you can see in lead, this is the lead V1. You have a small R wave. Then you have a slightly more prominent R wave in V2. Then V3, it become more taller and taller. So the R wave usually progresses from the small to much taller in from V1 to V6. So this is typically happens in a normal ECG. So it becomes small to tall. So this is a normal R wave progression. Now sometimes you can have sort of some other sorts of problem with ECG, like an artifact or tremors. I will show you what it is. So when you take this ECG, you can see that when you look at the lead two, you can see there is a PQRST normally. Then there is something in between. There is some abnormal wave in between. Again, you have a PQRST like that. So it is going like that. But the problem is that there is an abnormal something here. But when you see the other leads, you can see there is no such finding. Only this finding is present in lead one and lead two. So this is actually an artifact. So you should not interpret that as an abnormal wave. It's an artifact only. It happens usually due to the patient movement or machine errors. So make sure that you can identify an artifact on the ECG. Next is something called the wandering baseline. So this ECG, it was very well fine, but till the end, you can see that the ECG starts sagging. The wave starts sagging and it again goes up. Sometimes this may go haywire. The baseline may go like this. When you have baseline, it's called the wandering baseline. The problem is that you cannot interpret ST elevations, ST depressions, and T inversions, everything you will get wrong because the baseline is not correct. So again, this happens due to the patient movement. And when you have a wandering baseline, always take a fresh ECG. When you have an artifact or wandering baseline, take a fresh ECG. And this is another unusual scenario where you can see that the baseline is not regular. Baseline, you can see it is a lot of fluctuations are there. Baseline is going on, fluctuating. So this may be a finding. Sometimes this may be due to a condition. If the rest of the waves, everything is normal, this may be due to tremor, which can be seen in Parkinsonian patients or can be seen in elderly population. You can see tremor. So this may can also interfere with your reading of the baseline. So after ruling out all these things, you look for the information on the ECG. The patient demographics is very important. Then look at the standardization of the ECG. Then the speed with which ECG is recorded and the voltage with which ECG is recorded. Then calculate the heart rate and look for the measurements. Then calculate the rhythm, look for the rhythm. Then what is the axis? And look for any specific waves, any signs of chamber enlargement, that is right ventricular or left ventricular or atrial enlargement, any features suggestive of ischemic changes. So this is how you stepwise look forward in an ECG. The patient demographics is very important because in a busy ward, you may have some 20-30 patients and you will be interpreting an ECG. And sometimes the ECG may not be of that patient. ECG may be of someone else. So make sure that you are reading that patient's on ECG. Make sure that this is so-and-so patient, age to so-and-so, IP number is the same, and the patient's on ECG. Then only otherwise you may go wrong and may create confusion. So after that, next is the standardization. So after checking the patient demographics, you go on to the standardization. What do you mean by standardization? It means that the initial part of the ECG, whenever it begins, it will show a wave like this. Okay. So this part is called the standardization of the ECG. So normally this means that when you give 1 millivolt of current, it produces a 1 centimeter deflection. So that is the standardization. That is the machine is standardized like that. So normally you can see a deflection of a 10 millimeter deflection for a 1 millivolt. And this, it should be a perfectly right angled like this. This is the normal standardization. But if the ECG leads are not properly pressed on the ECG paper, or it is overpressed on the ECG paper, it may produce a phenomenon called damping. Okay. So under damping means the lead is not touching properly. It's very touching very faintly on the paper. And this may result in the leads more jumping more high. And this may result in an abnormally large wave. The voltage may go higher up falsely. Similarly, if it is overdamped, that means the lead is pressing more strongly on the paper, it becomes underdamped. So the edges become curved like this, and it may show an abnormally short voltage compared to a normal one. So this is why it is important that you should look for the presence of standardization, whether it is correct or not. Now, next, coming into the finding the heart rate. Okay, so after you have checked for the standardization, patient demographics, and check the if it is the speed is normal or like that, then you have to find the heart rate. Now, how do we find the heart rate? It's actually very easy. You have to find out the RR interval. RR interval means the difference between two successive R waves. Okay. So if you can calculate in big squares or small squares, and 300 divided by RR interval in big squares is called, you can calculate, that is one way of calculating the heart rate is 300 divided by RR interval in big squares. Another more accurate way is 1500 divided by RR interval in small squares. It takes more time and it sometimes may need a calculator, but most often 300 by RR interval in big square can give you roughly what is the heart rate. Let us see an example. Okay. So this is a ECG. So you have to calculate the rate based on this formula. So you can see that whenever you have a, this is called the rhythm strip. You can see the lowermost part of the ECG is called the rhythm strip. And you have to take the how many big squares are between. You can take between these two. You can calculate that it's about roughly about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Almost it's about 8 big squares, isn't it? So this, using this formula, that is 300 by 1. If it is the RR interval is 1 big square, it is 300 by 1. The heart rate is 300. If the RR interval is 2 big squares, it is 300 by 2 or 150 is the rate. If it is 3, it is 100, 4, 75, like that. So you can calculate very easily what is the heart rate. So in this given example, which I have shown you, the difference was 8 big squares. So when you divide 300 by 8, you get something roughly around 37. So the heart rate is 37. So that indicates that patient is having a bradycardia. So this is how you calculate the rate based on the RR interval. As you know, more than 100 is tachycardia and less than 60 is considered bradycardia. So this was the previous ECG which we have seen, and this indicates the patient is having a bradycardia. Now another example we will see this with this ECG. So you can take the lower, whenever you get a 12 lead ECG like this, you can see the lead 1, lead 2, lead 3, AVR, AVL, AVF, and the chest lead. But the lead 2 will be given downwards as a single long strip. This is called the rhythm strip. Okay. So whenever you have to assess the rate and rhythm, it is just good to look at this only, this part only. Okay. So look at this and calculate the rate. So you can see that the it is roughly about two big squares. You can see in between two big squares. So it is 300 by 2. The rate is 150. That means that the patient is having a tachycardia. Okay. Hope you understood how to calculate the rate. Now, after looking at the rate, you are looking at the rhythm of the heart. So for that, again, you have to look, utilize the rhythm strip, which is given at the bottom of the 12 leads. And the points you have to stress when you are calculating the rhythm or looking at the rhythm is the rhythm is regular or irregular? Is the RR, the QR, each QRS is coming at a regular interval or it is coming at irregular intervals? Again, important another point is that you have to check for whether there is a P wave is present before every QRS complex. Each QRS, check that whether there is a P wave is present or not. And look for any abnormally shaped or abnormal type of beats are present compared to a normal PQRST. Okay. Let us see an example. So here you have to assess the rhythm of the heart. And for assessing the rhythm, you look at the rhythm strip, which is given below. That's the lead to rhythm strip is given below. And now we can see there is a P wave, there is a QRS complex, there is a T wave, there is another PQRST. So this seems fairly regular. See, the RR interval is the difference between the RR interval is roughly about four big squares. And if you check, it is consistently like that. And for each QRS complex, there is a P wave is coming. So naturally, this is a normal sinus rhythm. P wave means every QRS having a P wave means the rhythm is originating at the SA node only. So it is a sinus rhythm. So this is an ECG showing a normal sinus rhythm. This is what I was mentioning by RR interval. Look at the difference between the two RRs, successive RRs. Now let us see this example. What is the rhythm? Now we will see abnormalities in the rhythm and you have to identify based on the thing we have just learned now. Okay. So let us see this rhythm strip. I am giving the rhythm strip only. So you can see, first of all, is the RR regular? You can see that RR in, you can see that the RR, that if two QRS waves are not coming at regular intervals here. Here you can see the RR, the difference is roughly about four big squares. But when you come here, it is only two big squares. So that means the RR is not regular. So this is an irregular rhythm. Okay. So first of all, you have identified this is an irregular rhythm. It is not a regular rhythm. Next point, we learned that whether to check the any P wave is present before the QRS complex. Now, can you identify from this ECG? So you can identify some lot of baseline waves are there, but you cannot identify a single identifiable P wave is absent in this ECG. What you can see is only irregular baseline and a lot of RRs, a lot of QRS complexes coming at irregular intervals. So whenever you have an irregular heart rhythm, the first thing that is coming to mind is atrial fibrillation. So this is very a classical ECG of atrial fibrillation where there is no P wave and the RR is coming at different variable intervals. So this is very classical of atrial fibrillation. Now let us see another ECG. Now here there is an ECG, again a rhythm strip only. So you can see that when you see the baseline is not regular actually, it's not a flat line. It is coming as a, some numerous waves are there, which is coming at fairly equidistant numerous waves are there, which is appearing like a sawtooth. So the end is something like a sawtooth. But if you see the QRS complexes, you can see the QRS complexes are coming at fair regular intervals. Okay, it is coming at regular intervals. You can see that the difference is roughly about four big squares in between each RR. That means QRS complexes are coming at regular intervals, but what you are seeing at the baseline is not, there is no identifiable definite P wave. What you are seeing is this abnormal sawtooth waves. So this is very characteristic of a condition called atrial flutter. So imagine the atrial flutter means the baseline will be something like a sawtooth waves coming at regular intervals. And at fixed, about four such waves are there, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then you have a QRS complex. Again, 1, 2, 3, 4, a QRS complex, like that. So this is an atrial flutter with a fixed block. Fixed block means at every four waves, then you're getting a QRS complex. So this is an atrial flutter. So whenever you're seeing a sawtooth waves in the baseline, and the QRS complex is coming in between, this is suggestive of an atrial flutter. If the atrial flutter is having a fixed block, the QRS complexes will come at regular intervals. But if the atrial flutter is having a variable block, then the QRS may come at variable intervals. So that's the difference between atrial flutter with fixed block and variable block. So that's the second abnormal rhythm we have studied now. After the normal sinus rhythm, we have seen atrial fibrillation, and next is atrial flutter. Now, this is another interesting ECG. This may not be that much relevant for an undergraduate, but still, when you are for completion's sake, I'm adding this. Let us see what is the finding here. Here you can see there is a P wave. Definitely, there is a P wave here, and there is a QRS complex here. Then you have another P wave, another QRS. So definitely, each QRS complex is followed. There is a P wave for that. Only problem is that it is not coming regularly. There is some difference between the RR interval is not regular, but definitely the rate is higher. You can see that the rate is higher. There is some tachycardia there. There is a tachycardia. But the important finding in this ECG is that the P wave, this P wave denoted as P wave A, is not similar to P wave B. B is an abnormal type, another type of P wave. And when you see the C is again different because the tip is peaked and it is more broader, and D is a very small. There are different types of P waves are coming. So whenever you see a different more than three type of P wave morphologies in a tachycardia, this is termed as multifocal atrial tachycardia. This is another abnormal arrhythmia you may see. This is not commonly seen, it's a rare arrhythmia. So this is due to multiple atria. Coming to another scenario, another ECG. So what is the rhythm here? Again, whenever you are asked about the rhythm, you go into the rhythm strip. PQRST is there. Then what you're seeing is something abnormal jumping there. Okay, there is an abnormal wave. That I was telling, to look for abnormal waves. So here you have an abnormal wave, which is a broad complex, a wide wave. You cannot identify any definite P on that, but you can identify something like a very broad and QRS complex. It is looking something like that. Then again, looking continuously, you can see another normal PQRST. It is going like that. But after some time, again, you are seeing a couple of such beats are coming together. Okay. So these are the abnormal beats. So whenever you see such a broad complex beat, this is called an ectopic beat, or it is a ventricular ectopic beat. So otherwise called premature ventricular complex, or PVC. Okay. So it may be of different size and shape. So this PVC is different from this PVC. All of these are broad complex waves because it is originating from the ventricles. It is a broad complex wave. While this is a sinus beat, you have a definite P wave for that. But for ectopic beat, there is no P wave. What you are seeing here is the T wave of the previous QRS complex. So there is no P wave for this. This is a ventricular ectopic. And this is usually followed by a compensatory pause. So there will be a long isoelectric segment, which is called the compensatory pause. And after which the heart again recovers by a sinus rhythm. So this is called an ectopic beat, or premature ventricular complex. Now let us see what is the rhythm here. So far we have learned that the ECG should have a regular rhythm, P wave, check whether the P wave is present for each QRS complex, and look for abnormal beats. Okay. So here again, look at the rhythm. It's a PQRST, it's normal. Here what you are identifying, it has previously seen, this is a ventricular ectopic. Then you have a normal sinus rhythm, then another ectopic. Then you have a sinus rhythm, another ectopic, sinus rhythm, another ectopic. So you can see that each of these normal sinus rhythm beats is followed by a ventricular ectopic. So this phenomena is called ventricular bijeminy. Okay. So that means every sinus beat is alternated by a ventricular premature complex. So this is called a ventricular bijeminy. This produces a characteristic pulse finding called the pulsus bijeminus, or a double beating pulse. Okay. Now let us see what is this rhythm. So based on the fact you have identified that this is a fairly regular rhythm, you can see the QRS complexes are placed equidistantly. The QRS complex is somewhat rather widened, as if you are seeing an ectopic beat. So it is something like a ventricular origin. Probably this may not be an atrial origin. And you can see that there is no P wave seen before this QRS complex in any of this. Okay, you cannot identify any P wave. So that means this is not of a atrial origin. This has to be ventricular origin. Now, this is a ventricular origin, and this is a broad complex. But what is the rate? When you calculate the rate, it is roughly about 3 and a half, roughly about 4. So the rate is not, there is no tachycardia as such. The rate comes around 75 to 80 and there is no tachycardia. So this is like a ventricular ectopic which is coming on, keep on coming at a slow intervals. So many times you may be mistakenly called this as a ventricular tachycardia, but actually there is no tachycardia in this ECG. The rate is normal. So when you see a broad complex rhythm coming without any P wave and it has got no tachycardia, this is called the idioventricular rhythm or accelerated idioventricular rhythm or the AIVR. So the importance of this rhythm is that this is whenever you treat a myocardial infarction, sometimes as your treatment goes on, your coronaries get opened by the streptokinase or the thrombolysis you are giving. And this, when there is reperfusion into the obstructed areas, this produces this rhythm. So AIVR is actually a rhythm showing reperfusion or otherwise called the reperfusion arrhythmia. Okay. So sometimes when you are thrombolyzing a patient, you are observing the monitor, you may sometimes see this rhythm. You may be suddenly wondering whether the patient is going into ventricular arrhythmia. But see, this is not a tachycardia. So this is an accelerated idioventricular rhythm. This does not require any active management. It spontaneously subsides once the reperfusion is complete. So this is the accelerated idioventricular rhythm. Now let us see another example. Okay. So again, don't look at the above portion. Look at only at the rhythm strip. Okay. So here, from here onwards, you can see the same thing. It's a broad complex tachycardia. By tachycardia, I can calculate the heart rate, and it is again more than 100. So that means it is tachycardia only. And you have, what you have seeing is a broad complex tachycardia, which is coming at fairly regular intervals. The previous one we were seeing is somewhat like this, but there is no tachycardia here. But here there is a broad complex and there is tachycardia there. So whenever you have a broad complex tachycardia, the first and foremost diagnosis you have to entertain is that of a ventricular tachycardia, otherwise called the monomorphic ventricular. Monomorphic means all beats are looking alike. You can see that each of these beats is looking alike. So, and this is coming at a tachycardia rate, and the tachycardia rate and the complexes are broad complex. So this is a monomorphic ventricular tachycardia. Okay. Now let us see. So this is the definition of a monomorphic VT. So the heart rate should be usually greater than 120 beats per minute, and at least 3 wide QRS complexes in a row should be there. So previously we were seeing some couplets. Remember that previous ECG where you have seen 2 beats. So remember this, you can see there are 2 beats are coming. So this is a couplet actually. When you have a 2 coupled beats coming, you cannot call it as a ventricular tachycardia. But if it is more than 3 or more coming together, you can call it as a ventricular tachycardia. So that is by definition. When you are having a 3 or more beats, wide QRS complexes coming in a row, you can diagnose it as ventricular tachycardia. Sometimes it may be spontaneously stopping or it may go on. In the previous ECG, you have seen that this is going on unless it is intervened, it is going on. So it is a sustained ventricular tachycardia. Now let us see this ECG. So in this ECG, you can see that, look at this part. Here there is a broad complex rhythm coming, then you have it's going at a tachycardia rate, so definitely it is a ventricular tachycardia. But after some time, after about 5 beats, then it subsides and it going into a P wave. You can see a sinus beat comes up, so that means the ventricular tachycardia has stopped here, but it comes at a later period, but still it is not sustained. So it is otherwise called a non-sustained or ill-sustained ventricular tachycardia. So a 3 beats is enough for say it is a ventricular tachycardia, and if it is keep on coming, it is a sustained ventricular tachycardia. And if it is spontaneously subsiding, it is called a non-sustained ventricular tachycardia. So that's a different type of rhythm which can you get in ventricular tachycardia. Now moving on, this is another example. So whenever you are here, we are assessing only the rhythm. Okay, so you check the rhythm strip alone. Okay, you can see that here. You are not able to identify any definite P wave. You can see a QRS complex, which is actually narrow. It's not a broad complex. QRS complex is narrow. QRS complex, the maximum width is only 3 small squares. So anything less than 3 small squares is considered as a normal QRS complex. So here, what you are seeing is a narrow complex rate. And what is the rate? Rate is, it is more than 150. So it is a tachycardia only. But what you are seeing is something called the narrow complex tachycardia compared to the broad complex tachycardia we have seen previously. So the broad complex tachycardia, the most important example is ventricular tachycardia, while a narrow complex tachycardia, the typical example is the supraventricular tachycardia. So this is a narrow complex, irregular, and the rate is high. Okay, so this is very characteristic of a supraventricular tachycardia. Many times the P wave cannot be seen here because the P wave gets submerged in the coming QRS. So there is a mixing, the QRS lands upon top of the P and the P is usually missed. Or sometimes very rarely you may have something called retrograde P waves. Okay, that is not much important. Okay, now some more ECGs on rhythm. Okay, so here you can see, look at this rhythm strip only. This is a fairly normal sinus rhythm going on. You can see a P, QRS, T, everything is going on fine. Until this moment, you can see the rhythm goes haywire. And what you can see is again a broad complex tachycardia. So the rate is definitely tachycardia. And you can see a broad complex tachycardia. It is going fairly regular manner. But what is different from the previous VT we have seen, monomorphic VT you have seen, is that here the all complexes are not looking the same. Some are small, some are tall, some are going downwards, some are upwards. So that means the VT, this is a VT only, but this is not a monomorphic VT. This is twisting upon the point. Something is going on the up direction, something is going on the down direction. So this is classically an example of a polymorphic VT, otherwise called the torsades de pointes, which you might have heard previously. Okay. So this is torsades de pointes, means twisting of the point. Okay. So whenever you have a broad complex tachycardia, which with each of the wave is looking not similar, then it is called a polymorphic VT. And finally, there is one more rhythm example. Here, when you see this rhythm, the rhythm is very important because assessing the rhythm sometimes saves a life. So there is no time to assess the rest of the ECG. Sometimes just looking at the monitor, you see this rhythm, you have to act immediately. Otherwise, the patient may have bad consequences. Okay. So here, when you see this rhythm, what you can see that if you try to identify whether it is a, there is no demonstrable P or QRS, nothing is there. What you can see is total chaotic pattern of waves. This is just like scribbling of with a pen. You just scribble something in the ECG paper. So it is totally chaotic, irregular. There is no identifier, P or QRS, nothing is there. So this is very characteristic of ventricular fibrillation. So here the ventricular fibrillation. If you see this rhythm in the ECG monitor, you have to immediately give a defibrillation shock. You have to shock the patient. Otherwise, the patient may die. So it's a matter of time only. So that is the importance that if you identify this rhythm in the monitor, immediately you have to take charge the defibrillator and give a DC shock to the patient. Otherwise, the patient may die in front of you. So that's the importance of identifying all these different type of rhythms. So in the rhythm, we have seen a normal sinus rhythm. Then atrial fibrillation we have seen. Atrial flutter we have seen. We have seen supraventricular tachycardia, the ventricular ectopics, ventricular bigeminy, ventricular tachycardia, that is monomorphic as well as polymorphic, and lastly the ventricular fibrillation. So we have seen all these rhythms when you are discussing the rhythm. Now let us move on to the next part, that is the axis. So far we have discussed about the how to calculate the rate, how to assess the rhythm of the heart, and the third thing is the axis. So I have previously mentioned about the Eindhoven's triangle and the various the vectors and the various leads. Okay, so these are the basic lead 1, lead 2, and the lead 3, and the net vector of the all these comes together in this direction. So this is the normal cardiac combined vector, and so this vector can range from minus 30, that is from the AVL minus 30 to plus 90. So this is this green colored area is the normal electrical axis of the heart. So anywhere it can be directed in between that particular limits. If the axis, if you calculate, is going beyond this AVL into the minus, it is called left axis deviation. And if it is going beyond towards the right side, beyond the 90 degree, it is called right axis deviation. So I will just summarize. There are different methods to calculate the axis, but I will give you only one method how to assess the axis. The simple method using two leads, that is lead 1 and AVF. So remember where the lead 1 and the AVF was. Lead 1 is at 0 degree and AVF is at 90 degree. Okay. Lead 1 is at 0, AVF is at 90 degree. So based on these two leads, you are trying to calculate the axis. So if the check first for the lead 1. Lead 1, this is actually a positive wave. See, you can see that the lead 1, it is a positive deflection. So whenever a lead is placed and the vector is coming towards that lead, it is picked up as a positive deflection. And if a vector goes away from the lead, it is picked up as a negative deflection. Okay. So in lead one, you are seeing a positive deflection. That means it is the lead one is positive. And look at the AVF. What happens in AVF? AVF is, so you can see it is a positive. So if the lead one is positive and AVF is also positive, that is a normal axis. So simply by calculating, looking at whether the lead one is positive and AVF is positive, you can identify it is a normal axis. Now let us see what happens in this. See the lead one? Lead one is positive. But when you look at the lead AVF, you can see that it is predominantly in the negative direction. Okay, you can see that the deflection is more towards the negative direction. Sometimes you may see a deflection on both sides, like there is an up deflection and a down deflection. But look at which is more. So, okay, suppose here in the lead AVF, you can see the negative deflection is much larger compared to a small positive deflection here. So net vector is negative in lead AVF. So whenever the lead one is positive and the AVF is negative, this is called left axis deviation. So this is going beyond this direction, it's called the left axis deviation. The next example, here you can see the lead one, there is a positive deflection and negative deflection as well, but the negative is more than positive. So net vector, you can take it as lead one is negative, and AVF, you can see that AVF is positive. So when the lead one is negative and AVF is positive, so that means the vector is, net vector is towards this direction, that is called the right axis deviation. Okay, so these are the examples for the left axis deviation and right axis deviation. So this is what we have just learned now. Lead one positive, AVF positive is normal. Lead one positive, AVF negative is left axis deviation. Lead one negative, AVF positive is right axis deviation. And suppose in a rare, very rare situation, you may get both as negative, then this is called either northwest axis or extreme right axis deviation or extreme left axis deviation. Okay, here it comes in somewhat in this territory. This is called the northwest axis. Okay. So this is an example. Again, we have learned what it is. Now we'll again as an example. Look at the lead one. Lead one is positive. So lead one is positive. Look at the AVF. AVF is negative. So what it is? Lead one is positive and AVF is negative. So it is a left axis deviation. So this is how you simply calculate the axis. This is only the one of the methods. There are numerous other methods, but I don't want to confuse you. Since we are talking about the basics only, so I just want to show one method to calculate the axis. The causes of axis deviation are numerous causes, but simply for you to remember, left axis deviation is caused by left ventricular hypertrophy and caused, it is also seen in inferior wall myocardial infarction, while right axis deviation is caused by right ventricular hypertrophy and anterior wall myocardial infarction. So these are two examples which you can easily remember. For axis deviations, left axis deviation and right axis deviation. Now we will be moving into each specific wave and the abnormalities in the wave. Okay, first into the P wave and the PR interval. So whenever you look at the P wave, it is very important to identify that whether there are P waves first. So identifying the P wave is very important, and then only you can identify a lot of things about the rhythm. And usually the P waves are looked in lead 2 and V1. These are the two leads where you look for the P waves. The P waves can get abnormal when P waves, as you know, P wave means atrial depolarization. So any change in the atria or the atrial pathology reflects in the P wave. So if you have a left atrial enlargement, you get a bifid P wave, which is called the P mitral. You might have heard this in relation to mitral stenosis. In mitral stenosis, as you can imagine, the mitral valve is small, it is stenosed, so the left atria undergoes enlargement. So this is characteristically seen as a P mitral. And if you have a right atrial enlargement, you get a finding called a pointed P wave, which is called the P pulmonate. Okay, I will show you this. So this is, when you look at this P wave, this is the P wave here. So whenever you look at the P wave, it is either in the lead 2 or in the V1. These are the two areas that you look for. In the lead 2, when you see, So here you can see the P is like something like a bifid P. There are two peaks for this P. Similarly, in the V1, you can see a large negative deflection corresponding to this. So this is called the P mitral, which is characteristically seen in left atrial enlargement. Now the next one is, you can see this. When you see this P wave, you can see it's a peaked pointy P wave like this. The P is very tall and pointed and peaked. This is characteristic of P pulmonale, which is characteristically seen in right atrial enlargement, commonly seen associated with COPD, such conditions. There is core pulmonale, you can get such findings. The right atrial enlargement may be present. So these are the two abnormalities you are seeing in the P mitral and the P pulmonale. So this is what you are seeing is the definition. It may be slightly difficult to remember for you, but you can learn that later. How much it should be elevated, like more than 2.5 millivolts should be elevated to say it's a P pulmonary, like that. So this is, but you have to understand the fact that if you have a pointed tall PV, it's a P pulmonary. And if it is a bifid PV, what you get is a P mitral. Just remember that. Now moving on to the PR interval. PR interval, I have already told you before, that is from the beginning of the P wave to the end of the PR segment, okay, or beginning of the QRS. So this comprises the PR interval. That means it includes the P wave and the PR segment. Okay, the normal duration you have to definitely remember, this you can easily remember by this 3 to 5 small squares. So if you cannot remember the seconds, then you remember at 3 to 5 small squares. So this distance should be 3 to 5 small squares. Okay, now let us see what are the abnormalities. Okay, so what you call as whenever you have an abnormality in the PR interval, you call it as a heart block. Okay, so there is something abnormal. The first thing you might have learned about heart block, but just tell you, the first degree heart block is indicated by the characteristically by the prolonged PR interval. Okay, you can identify from this ECG that this is from the starting of P and towards the end of QRS complex. This is definitely more than a big square. That means it has exceeded the upper limit of a 3 to 5 small squares. 5 small square means 1 big square. So if the PR interval is more than 1 big square, that means it is definitely abnormal. And if it is prolonged, that means it is a first degree heart block. There are some conditions where you have get a short PR interval and a long PR interval that you will learn later. There are different syndromes associated with this, like WPW syndrome, which is associated with the Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome, associated with a short PR interval. Here, when you have a long PR interval, it is called a first degree heart block. Now, coming into the next type of heart block. So whenever you're dealing with PR interval, you have to learn the heart blocks. The second degree heart block can be further divided into two types. This is the type 1 second degree heart block, otherwise called the Mobitz type 1 heart block, or otherwise called the Wenckebach's phenomenon. These things you might have learned previously. So usually what happens in this type of heart block is that there is a progressive prolongation of PR interval. So first there is a normal PR interval, then the next bit there is a more longer PR interval, then it increases progressively, and subsequently one of the QRS complex gets skipped. So this is characteristically seen in a Wenckebach's phenomenon. Let us see the ECG. So look at the rhythm. So here you can see a P wave, then you have the PR interval is fairly normal. But here you can see that the PR interval is actually more than 1 big square. So it is getting prolonged now. Now here it is again further prolonged. You can see it is further prolonged. And again, so it is getting more and more. So progressively the PR interval is getting increased and increased. And finally, here you can see there is a P wave is here, but there is no QRS here. Again, another P wave, and then followed by the same phenomenon which repeats. Okay. So this is the classical Wenckebach's phenomena, where there is progressive prolongation of PR interval, followed by finally there is a skipping of beat. So this is very characteristic of a Wenckebach's phenomena or type 1 second degree heart block or Mobitz type 1 heart block. Now let us see the type 2 or the second degree heart block type 2 or the Mobitz type 2. It is actually a disease of the His-Purkinje system, more distal. The problem is more distal compared to the type 1. And this is otherwise called the 2:1 heart block or 3:1 heart block. The problem is that this is a fairly dangerous disease. It can progress to complete heart block. And the patient may experience a sudden collapse or something called a Stokes-Adams attack. When the patient suddenly develops a advanced heart block and the patient collapses, this is called a Stokes-Adams attack. So you can see from the ECG what is happening. Okay, so at that red arrow is indicating a P wave. The second red arrow is indicating another P wave. So that means there was no QRS complex in between. So there are one P, another P, then there comes a QRS complex. So there is another P, another P. So that means the P is coming fairly regularly, but the problem is that the QRS complex is coming only after two P's. So one P wave, another P wave, then you have a QRS complex. Similarly, one P wave, another P wave, then you have a QRS complex. So this is very characteristic of a 2:1 hard block or Mobitz type 2 hard block, 2:1 hard block. Suppose you are getting 3 P waves followed by a QRS complex coming regularly. This is called a 3:1 hard block, like that. So this is a fairly advanced type of hard block. And finally, you have the complete hard block. Complete hard block means that you can imagine the conduction between the atria and the ventricles is completely cut off. So the atria beats at its own rate, that the PP rate goes at a fixed rate. But the problem is that the conduction is not coming downwards. So what happens is that ventricle starts beating on itself. So the ventricle goes at RR. So RR goes at its own rate. So the P and R has absolutely no relation between them. And typically the RR, the ventricular rate will be much slower. So what you're picking as pulse will be a typical bradycardia. So the patient coming with a sudden onset chest pain and you are seeing a heart rate of some 30 or 40 and you are seeing this finding. So this is very characteristic of a complete heart block. This is characterized by another physical finding called cannon waves in the JVP. So whenever the P and the QRS comes together, it produces a cannon wave. This indicates a cardiac pacing. So you have to support with cardiac pacing, otherwise the patient may there may be complications. So let us see the ECG of a complete heart block. Just look at the rhythm strip only. I will show you with arrows. So that was a P wave. Then you have another P wave. Another P wave. So you can see the P wave is coming at a regular interval. So the P wave is coming at regular intervals. It is going at its own rate. And you can see that the QRS has absolutely no relation with the P wave. Here you have a QRS complex, another QRS complex, another QRS complex. So the QRS is going at fairly regular rate. P is also going at fairly regular rate. But the P and QRS has no relation. You can see that here the P, there is some PR interval is there, but here it is not that. Here also it is not that. So it's totally different. So this is very characteristic of a bradycardia. This is complete heart block. So when you see, this is an indication for immediate temporary pacing or permanent pacing. So this is in summary, this is a normal one. If you have a prolonged PR interval, this is called a first degree heart block. If you have a progressive prolongation followed by skipping of one beat, this is actually 2:1. This Venkibax is not shown in this picture. This is actually 2:1 heart block. For two P waves, you have one QRS. Then complete heart block means the P goes at its own rate, QRS has no relation. So this is a third degree or complete AV block. Okay. So we have finished the P wave. Remember the P mitral and the P pulmonary. And the PR interval, the normal interval was 3 to 5 small squares. And we have learned about first degree, second degree, and the third degree heart block, how to identify from the ECG. Next, we are going to the QRS. So QRS complex, as I previously mentioned, QRS is less than 3 small squares. The duration, the width of the QRS complex is less than 3 small squares. And whenever the QRS complex is widened, there are different possibilities. Sir. Most often it is a bundle branch block or it may be an ectopic beat. As we have previously seen, an ectopic beat may be wider. But if it is coming from normally from a sinus beat and if the QRS is widened, then there is something called bundle branch block has happened. Bundle branch, remember the left bundle branch and the right bundle branch in the conducting system. So the left bundle branch block will have a peculiar pattern and the right bundle branch block will have a peculiar pattern. Let us see what are those. So this is, as you can identify, this is a normal QRS complex. The width is less than 3 small squares. So that indicates that patient doesn't, this is a normal QRS complex. Now imagine, with this diagram, I want to show you an idea regarding how a bundle branch block develops. So imagine the road as the conducting pathway, which is downward, the left bundle branch or right bundle branch. Imagine a pathology, here some terrorists are blocking the road. So if you want to get to the other side of the road, the only way is passing through the jungle on either side. Okay. Similarly, if the conducting system is blocked by some infarct or some pathology has happened there, the impulse that is originating from the SA node has to reach the opposite myocardium. by traveling through the myocardium. It is something like going through the jungle. So it will take more time, isn't it? If you go by the road, you will reach more faster. But if you go by the jungle, it will take more time. Similarly, the QRS complex will be narrow if you go by the road. But if you go by the jungle or go by the myocardium, the QRS complex will be widened. So that is a concept regarding bundle branch block and QRS widening. Now here you can see, definitely there is a normal rhythm because there is a P wave is there and there is no tachycardia. So P wave is there, PR interval is fairly normal. But what you are seeing is a broad complex QRS. The QRS width is definitely more than 3 small squares. So what is your opinion that it is a bundle branch block? So whenever you have a sinus rhythm and the QRS complex is widened, that means there is a bundle branch block has happened. Now to identify the pattern, whether it's a LBBB or RBBB. So this is the typical example. So look at the V1. V1 is the crucial point here to identify. So if you see such a pattern, V1 or V2, okay, anything will do. So if you see a wide complex negative deflection, predominantly downwards, and it is wide complex, and predominantly negative deflection in V1 and V2, this is suggestive of a left bundle branch block. Okay, so if you see the V6, etc., it will be a positive deflection here. So here we are looking at the V1 and V2. If you are seeing a predominantly wide complex negative deflection, this is suggestive of a left bundle branch block. So by definition, QRS width is more than 3 small squares or 0.12 seconds, then it's a broad complex monomorphic R waves in V. Okay, this is the one. There is a broad monomorphic S waves in V1. Okay, this is what we are talking about. A broad monomorphic looking alike S wave in V1 and V2. This is suggestive of a left bundle branch block. So just identify this pattern. If you are seeing this pattern, you have to identify this as a left bundle branch block. Similarly, if you see this pattern, you see the CCD. It is a normal rhythm. You can see there is no tachycardia. The P wave is really normal, but you can see that the QRS is widened. But in the V1 and V2, you are not seeing a negative deflection, but you are seeing a predominantly positive deflection, widened positive deflection. Okay, that is the diagnosis of a RBBB. Or sometimes you see something like an M pattern. You can see something called an M, like an M. You have a R, then you have an S, small s, again another R. This is called the RSR dash. When you have a second R, you call it as R dash, R apostrophe dash. Okay, so this is RBBB, pattern called RBBB. Okay, right. So again, the criteria is QRS width is more than 3 small squares, and there is a RSR dash pattern in the V1, where the R dash is more than R. So here you can see the R dash, the first one is the R and this is the R dash. So R dash is much more taller than the R. When you see such a pattern, you call it as a right bundle branch block. So this is always identified in a sinus rhythm. You are identifying this right bundle branch block and left bundle branch block. Okay, there is something called left anterior hemi block. I think we can skip for the time being. Okay, now coming into chamber enlargement. So we have identified what is a normal QRS complex and what is a bundle branch block, and what is a left bundle branch block and a right bundle branch block. Now we are going into how to identify left ventricular hypertrophy and right ventricular hypertrophy. So this can be identified. First I will show the ECG, then we will move on to the criteria. So here, when you see this ECG, first of all, you look at the rhythm. Okay, it is a fairly sinus rhythm because P is present. QRS, there is no tachycardia, so fairly sinus rhythm is going on. And the QRS width is almost, there is slight widening is there, but still it is within the normal limit. But what you can see that the V1, there is a very deep S waves are present. And as you go on to the lateral leads, you can see that the V6 is having a very tall R wave. See this? There is a very tall R wave in V5, V6. So if you have a very tall R wave in V5, V6 and a very deep S wave in V1 and V2, so this is suggestive of a left ventricular hypertrophy. Or there is a criteria for that. So you just add on the sum of the S wave in V1 and the tallest R wave in V5 or V6. So if you add on that and if you get more than 35 millimeter, that is suggestive of left ventricular hypertrophy. Okay, so this is, if you calculate, this is 5, 10, 15, 20. This itself is 20. Then if you take the tallest R wave, this is 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. So if you add, that means it is definitely more than 35. the tallest R wave dimension plus the deepest S wave dimension, if you add, that is more than 35 means, that is, it is suggestive of 35 millimeter means more than 7 big squares. If it is more than 7 big squares, that indicates of left ventricular hypertrophy. Now let us see what is right ventricular hypertrophy. So in the right ventricular hypertrophy, what you are seeing is normally I have already told about what is an R wave progression. In R wave progression, you will see the V1 will be having the smallest R wave. Then it usually progresses upwards. As it reaches the V6, the R wave should progressively increase. But here what you are seeing is in V1 and V2, you are seeing a prominent R wave here. This should not be a normal pattern because you are seeing a prominent R wave in V1 and V2. So if the V2, you can see a small S wave as well. But if the R is more than S, or the R by S ratio, R is more than S, then that indicates it is a right ventricular hypertrophy. So RS ratio, or the R by S ratio is more than 1 in lead V1, indicates a right ventricular hypertrophy. So these are the simplest criteria to diagnose right ventricular and left ventricular criteria, left ventricular hypertrophy. Now there are numerous criteria as shown by this LVH. You have numerous criteria. What we have just learned is called the Sokolov and the Lyons criteria. That is S in V1 plus R in V5 or V6 more than 35 millimeter. This is called the Sokolov and Lyons criteria. There are numerous other criteria, but you just identify as a basic, you just identify the simplest criteria to diagnose left ventricular hypertrophy. So that indicates that we have finished the left ventricular hypertrophy and right ventricular hypertrophy based on the voltage criteria. Now let us see what is a Q wave. Okay. Normally, you can see, as you have seen in ECG, there will be a small negative deflection. See this? There is a small negative deflection in all ECGs. In the PQRST, the Q will be very small. What is the cause for this normal Q is that normally the depolarization of the ventricle starts in the septum, intraventricular septum. So the septum depolarizes from left to right. Okay. Septum depolarizes from left to right. So a lead usually picks up this as a small negative deflection, which is going away from the direction of the lead as a small negative deflection. So this is called the normal Q wave. So this new Q waves can be seen normally in V1, AVR and lead 3. You can see this Q wave. Not in all leads, but this V1, AVR and lead 3, you can see small Q waves, which is normal. But if the Q wave is very large and deep, see this Q wave is very large and very wide and very deep. If you see such a Q wave, it is always abnormal. So that means it is always corresponding to the next R. So if the Q wave is very small compared to the R, it is less than 1/4 of the R, then it is normal. But if the Q wave is, the depth of the Q wave is much larger and it's more than the 1/4 of the R height, then that means it is an abnormal Q wave. So it is considered as a pathological Q wave. Pathological Q wave indicates a myocardial infarction. So I will tell you in detail what is pathological Q wave. But these are the normal Q waves and the pathological Q waves. Now, okay, so this is that picture showing that. So whenever a myocardial infarction happens in the ventricular wall, there are three zones of myocardial infarction. Okay, this is the zone of ischemia. Whenever there's an arterial occlusion happens, the peripheral most zone is called the zone of ischemia, and which produces changes in the T waves. You can get T inversions or such changes, or ST depression, T inversion. Such changes will be present in the zone of ischemia. Now, in the zone of injury, what you get is a typical ST elevation. So, zone of injury, there's ST elevation, ST segment elevation. We'll see these two later. And finally, in the zone of infarction, so in the central portion, you get a zone of infarction. And this is characterized by a large negative deflection called the pathological Q wave. Okay. So, this is because this part of the heart becomes electrically inactive. So there is no electrical activation going on, something like a looking through a window. So a lead here will have no deflection towards this happen. There is no electrically neutral area. Imagine you are sitting inside a room and looking towards through a window to outside. So the lead which is sitting here is looking through this window of infarction into the deflection which is happening in the opposite wall. And that is picked up as a negative deflection. So that is called the pathological Q wave. Okay, so that's a mechanism for pathological Q wave. Now, that is regarding the Q wave. What is a normal Q wave and what is a pathological Q wave? Now, coming to the important last three segments, that is a ST segment, T wave, and the QT interval. So ST segment, you might have learned in different areas, like what is ST elevation, MI, you might have heard so many times, what is ST elevation. Okay, so ST segment is a very important segment, and ST segment can be either normal, may be depressed downwards, or it can be elevated. So all these are considered abnormal. Depression or elevation is considered abnormal. So if the ST depression, especially downsloping or horizontal ST depression, is considered abnormal, and ST elevation, whatever it is, taken as abnormal. So ST elevation, there are numerous causes. The most important cause is myocardial infarction. So here, this is what we have already seen, the previous diagram, the zone of ischemia, infarction, injury, and ischemia. In the classical site of injury, you get the finding called ST segment elevation. Here you can see the ST segment has elevated from the baseline. Okay, so this is very characteristic of a myocardial infarction. This means it's an acute emergency. You have to treat the patient then and there itself. And you have to either try thrombolysis or you have to go for percutaneous coronary intervention. That is angioplasty. Either of this you have to do. Otherwise, the patient can develop either complications, arrhythmias, or the patient may even die of myocardial infarction. So it's an acute emergency. So it is very important that you have to identify this pattern of ST segment elevation should be in your mind. This is very important. And you can see that as the ST segment elevation goes on, the ST segment, zone of infarction becomes larger and larger. If you don't do anything, the zone of infarction becomes much larger, and the ST segment elevation later comes down. Finally, what you get is a large Q wave. Okay, so this means that initially the Q wave was small. The next ECG, the Q wave starts beginning. Then the Q wave becomes much larger. As the ST segment elevation comes down, the zone of all these zones get converted into infarcted zone, and what you are getting is a simple, large, deep Q wave. Okay. So this is an example of another example. This is showing, what you are showing is a ST segment depression. So in this ECG, you can see that the ST segment, compared to the baseline, the ST segment is depressed. So it's an upsloping ST depression. So it is going like an upsloping ST depression. Here you are seeing a classical ST segment elevation. Okay, you can see the ST segment is going like this. So it's very classical of an ST segment elevation. You can see the same finding. Here you are seeing the V1, V2, V3, V4. In the V4, you are seeing ST elevation only. There is no Q wave. But here in the V2, you can see already Q wave has started forming. And the V3 also, the Q wave started beginning. If you don't treat this patient, the patient will develop ST elevation in the whole leads. And finally, ST elevation will come down. And there will be finally only a Q wave will remain. Okay. That means all of that heart segment become infarcted. And that will not function. And the patient may go into LV dysfunction later. So based on this various leads, which I have shown, the lead 1, lead 2, then the inferior wall, anterior wall, which I have described previously, you can easily identify which wall MI the patient is having. The V1 and V2 is corresponding to the septal leads. So we have a septal infarction. It considers anterior wall MI only. V3, V4 is corresponding to the typical anterior wall. So V1, V2, V3, V4 is an anterior wall MI. V5, V6 and the lead 1 and the AVL. Lead 1, AVL, V5, V6 corresponds to lateral wall, and 2, 3 and AVF corresponds to inferior wall. If you have changes of ST elevation in 2, 3 AVF, it is an inferior wall MI. If you have ST elevation V1, V2, V3, V4, it is an anterior wall MI. And lead 1, AVL, V5, V6, it is a lateral wall MI. So it is that is how you are identifying which wall myocardial infarction has happened. The same thing. Based on this, you can even identify which artery has occluded. For example, inferior. Take this inferior. 2, 3 AVF is the primary change. And this is basically either right coronary artery or left circumflex artery. These are the two culprits when you have an inferior wall MI. While in anterior, septal MI, V1 major artery, that is the culprit vessel. And other way, a very important thing you have to learn by learning the ECG is that ST elevation, not all ST elevation means myocardial infarction. There can be lot of other causes. There are lot of other causes, even though they are rare. If you see an ST elevation in the ECG, 95% it may be due to myocardial infarction only. But very rarely you may get other causes. So you have to just learn what are the common causes. There are numerous causes as shown by this picture. It's a mnemonic for remembering that. The classical one examples are, you can get something called early repolarization pattern, which is actually considered normal. So I will show you that diagram. And even when there is left bundle branch block, you may get something like an apparent ST elevation. Then some electrolyte abnormalities like hyperkalemia may lead on to this problem. or an acute pericarditis. Acute pericarditis can produce ST elevation. There are numerous other causes. In hypothermia, you will get an ST elevation pattern called the J wave, which is called the Osborne wave, which is seen in hypothermia. There are numerous other causes for ST elevation, not typical of myocardial infarction. So this is the J point elevation. So when you see this ECG, so first of all, you have to identify what is a J point. J point is the area where the QRS meets the ST segment. So this is a QRS, which means ST segment. So there is a point called J point. So this J point only gets elevated. So that is a characteristic pattern. If you see this ECG, sometimes you may get confused that this patient is having an ST elevation MI, but this is typically a normal variant. So how to differentiate between the J point elevation and the typical ST elevation MI is very important. So this is one of the characteristic examples. So this is typically a J point elevation, what you are seeing. J point elevation. So you can see the J point is actually elevated. Then the ST, even though the ST segment is elevated from the baseline, it is like a J point elevation. And the whole thing looks like this. So if you remember this, so if you see this pattern, that means so the so-called frowny pattern, this is suggestive of an ST elevation. But if you have a J point elevation, it is usually looking at like a smiley pattern. See, if it is a smiley pattern, that indicates it is a concave pattern, that's the J point elevation, but a convex up pattern or the frowny pattern characteristically seen in ST segment elevation. So this requires some amount of expert. Typical concave curved up pattern is typically seen in ST elevation MI. So coming on to the T wave, the T wave can be abnormal in so many conditions. A small T wave or flattened T wave may be seen in hypokalemia. A tall T wave or a peaked T wave may be seen in hyperkalemia. So potassium is basically affecting the voltage of T waves, because potassium is associated with ventricular repolarization. So any changes in potassium may lead on to changes in T wave. So a small T wave is seen in hypokalemia and a tall T wave is seen in hyperkalemia. Sometimes an inverted or biphasic T wave can be seen associated with myocardial infarction, that is previous ischemia or infarct, may also lead on to T wave abnormalities. So this is very classical. You can see a tall, pointed, peaked, tented T waves. This is very classical of hyperkalemia. Now here you can see a T wave which is actually biphasic. See this T wave? The T wave is going up, then the T wave is going down. So this is a biphasic T wave which is very characteristically seen with ischemia or infarction. So this is seen with the zone of ischemia, like you can see in non-ST elevation MI or unstable angina, you can get this type of patterns. Now this is one example. Okay, right, a patient with a chronic renal failure and atrophic kidney. So the patient has a renal failure and the ECG is given. So what is the finding? So similar type of, you can get even multiple choice questions. Nowadays you can get in entrance examinations, you may get an ECG and you may get four options. So you have to pick up what is the answer based on this. Okay, so that is the previous one was hyperkalemia. So this is the classical ECG of hyperkalemia. So basically calcium and the potassium are the two things that affects the ECG, T waves. Okay, so the potassium is, as I have discussed, low potassium is associated with a flat or low T waves, while a high potassium or hyperkalemia is associated with a tall T waves. So here what you can see is a large pointed T wave which is associated with hyperkalemia. The thing is that I already told that this may mistake an ST elevation. Okay, so if you are sometimes thinking, is it an ST elevation? The QRS is widened and the ST is elevated. So you may think that this is an ST elevation MI, but actually the patient is having hyperkalemia. So if the hyperkalemia is treated, everything goes back to normal. And if you, and this is the second example, that is hypokalemia. Here you can see the T wave is actually not much prominent, but what you are seeing as an abnormal wave after the T wave. So there is a P, QRS, then there is a T, then you can see an abnormal wave after that, before the next P. So this is a U wave. Okay, if you are seeing this wave, this is very characteristic of a U wave. So the T is not that much prominent, but you are seeing a prominent U wave. Sometimes the T may be even flattened or suppressed, and you are seeing a U wave along with that. This is suggestive of hypokalemia. Okay, so this you might have learned in your textbooks, what happens when the potassium value goes up to the ECG pattern. So in when the potassium value goes on decreasing, it is 2.5, that means the T wave get flattened. 2, that means stereo get inverted and the U wave starts appearing. And again, further lowing becomes a prominent U wave. So this is characteristically happens in hypokalemia. And in hyperkalemia, when the potassium goes up to 6.5, there's a tall T wave. Then 7, again, the QRS starts widening. Then finally, it becomes more than 8 or 9, it becomes something called a sine wave pattern. Okay, it looks like a sine wave. So this is the sine wave pattern which you're seeing in extreme hyperkalemia. So this is very important because not only ischemia and infarction, a lot of metabolic changes can affect the ECGs, and you can detect so many abnormalities from ECGs. So that is the importance of checking this finding. Next is calcium-related abnormalities. You have hypercalcemia and hypocalcemia. Okay, so I will discuss that. Normally what happens is that, this is the normal one, what happens in hypercalcemia is that the QT interval. So the QT interval is the one that is affected by hypercalcium levels. So the QT, when you have a hypocalcemia, the QT gets very much prolonged. The QT becomes very much prolonged. And the hypercalcemia, QT becomes very much shortened. So that is the relation. So potassium affects the height of the or the voltage of the T waves, while the calcium affects the duration of the QT interval. Okay. So similarly, you can see that in hypocalcemia, you can get the QT is very much prolonged. Okay. So you can see the hypocalcemia, QT is very much prolonged. So this is in nutshell, that is potassium, if the potassium is increased, the T wave goes up. Potassium is decreased, T wave goes down. Calcium, if it is hypocalcemia, the QT is prolonged. The hypercalcemia, the QT becomes natural by the potassium and the calcium elements. So then another abnormality which you may see is a giant T inversion. This you can happen following a cardiac arrest recovery, or for example, this patient developed a cardiac syncope, followed that cardiac arrest which has reverted. Sometimes you may see a large giant T inversion. And regarding the QT interval, I haven't discussed what is the normal QT interval. So QT interval always needs to be corrected for the heart rate. So normal QT interval will be something, but whenever the heart rate goes different, then you have to correct that for the heart rate. It is called the QTC, or the corrected QT interval is called corrected QT interval. This is normally should be less than 400 milliseconds. So it should be less than 400. The normal QTC should be less than 400 milliseconds. So that is how the calculation goes. So here you can see the typical, this going much, remember that 0.04 was the one small square and 0.2 was the one big square. So two big squares becomes more than 0.4. That is the one we are talking about. For more than 400 milliseconds means more than two big squares. If the QT interval is going more than two big squares, that indicates that QT is prolonged. So here you can see that the QT is starting from here to here, that definitely more than three big squares. So the QT interval is prolonged. Now there are numerous formula to calculate the corrected QT interval. This is the one example you have to learn is Bessette's formula. So take the QT interval and divide it by root of RR interval. If you calculate that, that becomes the corrected QT interval. So this you can, there are numerous calculators, online calculators available. Example in MedCalc like that, you can easily calculate put the QT interval value and put the RR interval, and you will get the corrected QT from the online calculator. So in this way, you can calculate corrected QT interval. Recently, you might have, this QT interval has come into focus in the COVID times, because COVID, when you treat with hydroxychloroquine was the one drug which we, at the beginning of COVID, we used to give. And usually it was combined with azithromycin, and combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin was known to prolong QT interval, and the patient may go into arrhythmias. So always, whenever you take, when you give this combination, you have to take an ECG and check for the corrected QT interval. So here, it becomes very important to calculate the corrected QT for all these patients before giving such a combination. Okay, so that's the importance of the QT interval. Again, it's the same thing. Then there are numerous congenital long QT syndromes. That is, by birth, the patient develops a long QT syndrome. This usually asked in entrance examination. There are numerous syndromes. Example is said Jarvell-Lange-Nielsen syndrome, Anderson syndrome, etc. These are all congenital long QT syndromes. Don't go into the details of that. Now, after so with that, I have finished, I think, in order, how to identify a normal ECG, what is a normal rhythm, rate, calculation of identifying the rhythm, what are the abnormal rhythms, then abnormalities in the P wave, PR segment, various hard blocks, QRS, what is the bundle branch block, then the ST segment, elevation, depression, all those causes, then the abnormalities in the T wave, and the QT interval finally. So this is, we have step by step, we have analyzed each of the segments of ECG. And now I will show you various ECGs. You try to analyze that. And I will wait for some time, but then I will tell the answer. And try to analyze this ECGs by whatever you have learned so far. Okay. So this is an ECG. You try to identify any abnormality which you can identify in this. Here, the history is given as a 45-year-old woman who is asymptomatic. You can try to interpret the ECG. So by step by step, if you look, whether see this is a sinus rhythm, yes, you can see a P wave is there. Look at the rhythm strip. This is a P wave is there. Then you have a QRS complex, you have a T wave, then you have P, QRS, T. So fairly, this is a sinus rhythm. Okay, right. Then the every QRS is preceded by a P wave, right? There is no issues. Look at the morphology of P wave is normal, fairly, no issues. QRS complex is normal. The axis, if you check the lead one, is positive. AVF is also positive, so it's a normal axis. Now, if you see the R wave progression is characteristically present, there is no issue. There is no ST segment elevation. There is no T wave abnormalities, nothing. So what is the problem we are missing? Yes, we haven't calculated the rate. Okay, so what is the rate, heart rate here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So 300 by 5. So that means it is 60. So if you take 60 as normal, then it is okay. But if you calculate more accurate, sometimes there is a chance of bradycardia. So here it is a normal sinus rhythm, but the heart rate is on the 60. Okay, right. This is another ECG. Now let us see what happens in the rhythm strip. A patient has dyspnea is the history. Always correlate to the history. Then only you start. If the patient comes with acute chest pain, you can think that it is a probable case of myocardial infarction. Like that, your impression should go. Okay. So if you look at this ECG, you can see fairly this is going at a normal sinus rhythm. There is a P wave is there, QRS, T, P, QRS, T, everything is coming. The rate is fairly normal. There is no other abnormalities. But if you check the PR interval, you can see that the P is here and the QRS is, and the PR interval is widened. So this is suggestive of a first degree heart block. So this is how you have to analyze and interpret and get to a finding. Okay. PR interval is more than 200 milliseconds, so it is a first degree heart block. Now let us see what is in this ECG. Here the history is given as a 79-year-old man, 45 minutes after receiving thrombolytic therapy for acute myocardial infarction. Now currently he is pain-free, he doesn't have any symptoms. So okay, so immediately when you hear that history, the thing should go in your mind. Okay, the patient is had a myocardial infarction, now the patient is developing reperfusion. So what was the thing we have learned about reperfusion? There was an arrhythmia, which is called the idioventricular rhythm, isn't it? Accelerated idioventricular rhythm. So let us check. So here what you are seeing is a broad complex rhythm, which is there is no tachycardia, there is no P waves are present. So it is fairly a rhythm which is going a broad complex rhythm going slowly. So there is no tachycardia. It's very characteristic of a accelerated idioventricular rhythm, isn't it? It's an idioventricular rhythm actually. It's not accelerated idioventricular rhythm only. Okay, right. Let us proceed with the next.
For that, one of our audience has answered as MI. So can you shed light on why?
Yeah, definitely. The question itself told that there is an MI is present. Okay. So that diagnosis matters here. Okay. It is correct actually. The patient has developed a large Q wave in the lead 2, 3 and AVF. So definitely this is an MI only. The patient is having a probably an inferior wall MI and the patient has been thrombolized. Everything history has been given for you. Okay. So MI diagnosis is already there. So I don't want another MI diagnosis is already given. So there is no need to further diagnose an myocardial infarction. Okay, if you are starting from NAVE, the history is not available, then you can definitely identify this as a large Q wave, which suggests you of which is present in the 2, 3 and AVF. So definitely it's an inferior MI. There is no ST elevation. That means a large infarct has already happened in the inferior wall. So the patient has undergone thrombolytic therapy. Now that's the importance of correlating with the history, isn't it? So rhythm now we are seeing is the accelerated idioventricular rhythm on top of an inferior wall myocardial infarction. Correct.
Okay.
Now this is another rhythm. example for a rhythm. Okay. 48-year-old woman reports severe lightheadedness while walking, and she started a new medication. She has started a medication for hypertension. That's a history. Giddiness, and you, she's coming for you. Okay. And you take an ECG, you can look for the rhythm only. It's a rhythm abnormality, so you look for that. Any answers?
No answers yet, sir.
No answers. Okay. This I will move on to analyze this. What you can see is at least you could have told that the patient is having bradycardia, isn't it? That is fairly simple. If you calculate the rate of this, you can see that definitely it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So definitely it is bradycardia. So the patient is having bradycardia. So that means the patient might be taking what type of antihypertensive? Most likely the patient might have started on a beta blocker, which reduces the heart rate for hypertension. Okay. And now let us check. The QRS is okay. Where is the P? Can you see a P here? There is no P here. Here, there is no P here. So absolutely, you cannot see a P here. So there is absolutely no P, but the QRS complex is narrow, followed by a T wave, and going at a bradycardia. So that means the rhythm is not originating at the SA node. If it was originating at the SA node, that means there should be having a P. But here there is no P wave. So the rhythm is originating, not, suppose it was in the ventricle, it is a broad complex rhythm. Here it is not broad complex. So this is originating somewhere in the junction of AV nodal junction. So this is otherwise called the junctional rhythm. Okay. It's otherwise called the junctional rhythm. So this ECG we haven't seen before. This is another example for an abnormal rhythm, the junctional rhythm. That means it is originating at the His bundle junction and is conducting downward. So there is no P will be there. The QRS will be narrow, but the patient will be having bradycardia. The rate will not be up to the level of SA nodal rhythm. This is a characteristic example of a junctional rhythm.
Sir, actually we had an answer like a bundle branch block.
Do you think there's a bundle branch block is there? Bundle branch block, the QRS should be more than 3 small squares. It is actually difficult to identify from because this picture is somewhat smaller, but still you can identify that this QRS is not that much widened. This is a one big square, which is comprising of 5 small squares, isn't it? And if you take the QRS width, it is not more than the normal one. Okay. Only if the QRS width is enlarged, then you can say bundle branch block.
Okay.
Here the QRS is in the normal limit only. So you cannot call it as a bundle branch block. So that's the problem with diagnosing a bundle branch block in this ECG.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. The next one. The history is that a 62-year-old man with renal failure complains of progressive dyspnea and orthopnea, and he missed his last two hemodialysis sessions. So that's the history. The patient is a chronic renal failure patient, and the patient has missed two hemodialysis sessions and is coming with dyspnea. Okay, any takers?
We don't have any answers yet, sir.
Yes. So if you analyze, you can actually jump into the answer because the answer is striking in front of you. But if you go in routine, you see that it is a sinus rhythm. The P is present.
We have got an answer now. It is hyperkalemia.
Yes, very good. Okay, so that's a good answer. So that means they have spotted this tall peaked T waves, isn't it? So the clinical clue is that patient is having a renal failure. So that is a situation of metabolic acidosis, which leads on to hyperkalemia. If you get an idea like that, if you have a clinical correlation of that patient and the ECG, then immediately it will strike to you that it's a hyperkalemia. So this is a normal, fairly sinus rhythm, but what you're seeing is a large peaked T waves, which is suggestive of a hyperkalemia. So that means immediately you have to give patient something. What do you give? You give calcium gluconate, or calcium gluconate is an immediate drug which is given to prevent arrhythmias due to hyperkalemia. So whenever you see this ECG, so immediately check for a serum potassium level and you give calcium gluconate for the patient to prevent a dangerous arrhythmia due to hyperkalemia. Okay, we shall move. Now, this is fairly maybe easy. 54-year-old man receiving, okay, here the diagnosis almost given. The patient after receiving thrombolytic therapy. Okay, the patient is having a thrombolytic, patient has received thrombolytic therapy. So what is the thing you are seeing in the ECG?
Tell the finding.
Yes, definitely you can pick up the easily after checking the go by the order. So I won't be going in that order because it takes much time to analyze each ECG. So in this ECG, I will go into the finding. And you can see the ST segment elevation. Definitely, there's an ST segment elevation. There is a large Q wave has formed. So V1, V2, V3, and V4, you can see the ST elevation is still there, and with the T inversion. So all these findings are suggestive of when you have in V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, still you have findings there. That means it's a large anterior wall. The patient has an extensive anterior wall MI for which patient has been thrombolyzed. And one pattern of this biphasic T wave in I have shown you that previous T wave. This biphasic T wave, along with ST elevation, there is a sign called Wellen sign. Okay, it's a sign called Wellen sign, W-E-L-L-E-N. You can see that there is a ST segment elevation with biphasic T waves, suggestive of Wellen sign. So this was the finding. There are numerous named signs in ECG. You might be, you can learn it one by one. It takes a lot of time. You have to, if you're interested, you can go into that field and you can identify so many abnormal ECGs. But I just want to give you, this is a very fairly common finding in an ST elevation MI.
So we have a doubt coming in. Yes. So how do we identify each wave on each lead? How do we identify the waves on each lead?
Pardon? I didn't get the question.
How can we identify, for example, PQ or ST waves on each lead? How can we identify these waves and be confident?
So if you take the lead two, this you identify a QRS complex. Okay, this is a QRS complex, and you can identify immediately before that it will be the T, and the T here is slightly flattened. So if you take this one, this is the QRS complex, and there is a P wave here, and you have the T here. What's the difficulty? It's actually fairly easy. So you identify the QRS complex in each lead, so that will give that the QRS complex. So the major vector will be the QRS complex. And you can check whether the P is present or what is abnormal to T. And relation to that QRS complex, you can further find out the rest of the waves. It is not that much difficult.
Okay, sir.
Then this is one rare ECG actually, because it is infrequently found. You may not be able to identify, but still I am giving this ECG. The patient is a 39-year-old male, and he is fairly asymptomatic. He came for routine checkup, and an ECG was taken from the casualty, from the OPD, and someone got worried after seeing this ECG. Patient is absolutely fine, no issues. Okay. Any abnormal finding which you can pick up?
Baseline is
fairly okay. There is not that much. It's mild. It's not a straight line. That's all. But it's not taken as abnormal. Here you can identify the PQ, RST. Everything is coming as normal. It's a sinus rhythm. It is regular. Everything is okay. Any finding which is striking other than that?
Sir, ST segment elevation.
Where is the ST segment elevation? Probably here, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
So what you can see here is a V1 and V2 is showing an ST segment elevation, isn't it? And you have a T inversion also. So, but it is not present in V2, V3, V4, V5, V6. So it is present only in V1 and V2. So that's a classical, that's a finding which jumps at you. So immediately, if you know that ST elevation corresponds to myocardial infarction, immediately you might be having a doubt, is this fellow having myocardial infarction? But he doesn't have any symptoms, he's absolutely fine. So that's here you have to think of a cause for ST elevation other than myocardial infarction. Remember that slide which I have shown you. There are numerous causes for ST elevation other than myocardial infarction. Okay, this is a condition called, I don't know whether you have heard of this thing. This is called Brugada syndrome. Okay, this is called Brugada syndrome, where you see ST elevation in V1 and V2 alone, and there is a right bundle branch block also. Can you see that? There is an R-S-R' pattern, the QRS is widened. So there is a right bundle branch block with ST elevation in V1 and V2. This is very characteristic of a condition called Brugada syndrome, which may be easily mistaken for a myocardial infarction. Okay, but the problem with Brugada syndrome is that this is not again a basic thing. This is a slightly advanced, but just I want to add, give an example. Brugada syndrome problem is that the patient are prone for developing various arrhythmias. So they may suddenly develop ventricular arrhythmias. So the problem is that such a risk is there. So you have to identify this ECG as Brugada syndrome, not ST elevation. ST elevation is right, but to say that correctly, it is a Brugada syndrome.
Okay. Sir, is there a J wave elevation? We have many answers coming in from the audience.
Okay, J point elevation, I already told that. Remember that smiley pattern? Okay, if you have a J point elevation, it will go, J point will go up, then you have a concave downwards, like this. It should come like this. It should not make like a doming pattern. So it should be, if you have a convex up is an ST elevation, and J point goes up and it is concave downwards, it should be, remember that smiley and frowny which I have shown, the frowny is suggestive of an ST elevation, while smiley is suggestive of J point elevation. So this is not J point elevation because here it is something like an upsloping only. ST elevation only, but it is not myocardial infarction. It's a condition called Brugada syndrome because it is characteristically seen alone in V1 and V2 associated with a right bundle branch block. So that is the example of Brugada syndrome. Okay, moving on. So some details, I'll skip that. Okay. What is this? Okay, right. The rhythm issue. A 41-year-old woman with nausea and vomiting. That's only the history given. Anything abnormal you can find out?
Irregular.
Yes, very good. So first of all, you are identifying this is a rhythm is not regular, isn't it? So rhythm is not regular. Okay, here the RR interval is this, but here the RR interval is very much less. Here again the RR interval. So what it is? Is it a, so it's an arrhythmia. So what type of arrhythmia it is? When you have an irregular rhythm, first point that comes into your mind is atrial fibrillation. So is this atrial fibrillation?
Sir, we have three different answers.
What you got? What are the answers you have got?
Ventricular bigeminy, atrial fibrillation.
No. All these waves are narrow complex. Okay. All these waves are narrow complex. You see the all the QRS, all are narrow complex QRS. Right? Isn't it? So this is not a ventricular rhythm. This is an atrial rhythm only. And check whether any P wave is present before the QRS. There is a P wave for QRS, P wave for QRS. Here also there is a P wave for QRS. So everyone is a sinus beat only. So every beat is a sinus beat, but that is coming at irregular intervals. So what it is likely to be? This is actually a premature beat. Okay. This is the first beat. This is the second beat. The third beat should come somewhere here. But actually the beat has come much earlier. Okay. It's a sinus beat only, but it has come earlier. So there is a premature atrial contraction. So it's actually atrial ectopic. You haven't seen this ECG before. That is why you're answering like that. This is an atrial ectopic only. That the clue is that this is it is having a P wave. So that means it's a sinus beat only, coming much earlier than expected. Okay. And it is followed by a pause. So it's a premature atrial contraction. It's fairly very normal. You can get any normal person can get occasional premature atrial contractions, which is very fairly common. So it's not an abnormal finding. It may sometimes may be precipitated in normal persons as well. That is this. Here you are seeing it's an atrial, it's not a ventricular trigeminy. Yeah, this is coming because every third beat it is perspirating. See this? After two sinus beats, there is an ectopic beat. Two sinus beats, ectopic beat. So it's a trigeminy pattern is coming, but it's an atrial beat only, not a ventricular beat. Okay. Then what is this? 68-year-old man with palpitations and generalized weakness. Maybe slightly difficult because these images are, I think, not that much clear, isn't it? Okay, I think I'll skip that. It's not that much clear. It's actually a flutter, but it is not that much clear. So I will skip that. Okay, what is this? This should be fairly easy. You have seen before. The rhythm strip only.
Rhythm strip only.
Any answers?
Sir, atrial fibrillation.
Atrial fibrillation.
Oh,
do you think this much wide complex is atrial fibrillation?
No, sir, at all.
This is a wide complex. Whenever see a wide complex, it is a ventricular origin. Okay. Remember that logic. Narrow complex is supraventricular, wide complex is ventricular. So this is a ventricular only. What is the rate?
The rate is high, sir.
It is high. That means it's a tachycardia. So it is a ventricular tachycardia only. It's fairly simple.
So ventricular fibrillation. Okay. We have an answer. Ventricular fibrillation.
No, this is not fibrillation. Fibrillation will be totally having no pattern at all. Here you are seeing some pattern, isn't it? Here the pattern, fairly there is a pattern is there. So it is not ventricular fibrillation. So it is a ventricular tachycardia.
Okay. Polymorphic ventricular tachycardia.
So this is a polymorphic ventricular tachycardia. This, we have seen this ECG before. So here you can see the complexes are varying and twisting. It is, some is going up, some is going down like that. Okay. So this is characteristic of a torsades de Pointes. Yes. Okay. And the characteristic treatment when you see torsades de Pointes is giving magnesium. Okay. Magnesium is one of the important drugs which you can give when the patient has torsades de Pointes. But it's a very dangerous arrhythmia. Okay, this I think not much important. This is something related to digitalis toxicity, I think, that I will skip. Okay, this one fairly easy. Yes. A 43-year-old man, left-sided chest pain and arm pain.
ST elevation.
Yes, very good. ST elevation. Which all leads you are seeing the ST elevation?
V5, V6.
Yes, V5, V6. And you can see, yes, don't forget this area also.
And you can see, don't forget this area.
Lead 1, AVL. So that is suggestive of?
So that is suggestive of
a lateral wall MI, isn't it?
Lead 1, AVL, and V5, V6 are
lateral leads. So this is suggestive of a lateral wall myocardial infarction. Okay, right. Now this one, again, fairly easy striking change. Here also it is a chest pain.
2-3
AVL. It is a very simple normal sinus rhythm. There is no tachycardia. The characteristic finding of a curving ST segment seen in 2-3 and AVF leads. So it's suggestive of inferior wall myocardial infarction. So you can, whenever you have an inferior wall myocardial infarction, see the, what happens in anterior leads. You can see that there is an ST segment depression in V1 and V2. Can you see that? ST depression, V1, V2, V3. So when you have an inferior wall ST elevation, you will have reciprocal changes in anterior wall. Similarly, in the previous ECG, you might have noticed that when there is a lateral wall or anterior wall ST elevation, you have reciprocal changes of ST depression in inferior wall. So this is simply a phenomenon of change of that vector. Okay. Once the ST elevation comes down, the reciprocal change also disappears. Okay. So whenever you have an anterior wall MI, there is a reciprocal changes happens in the inferior wall. And when you have an inferior wall MI, reciprocal changes happens in the anterior wall. Okay. Right. This is, again, you will skip the T inversion only. You can see that the patient is having a T inversion in AVF lead 2, lead 3. So this is the ischemic changes. That is unstable angina or non-ST elevation MI. Okay. And the rhythm is actually junctional here. So actually there were a lot of findings here. Like patient is having a bradycardia. See that the rate is less bradycardia. There is no P wave here. So that means the patient is in junctional rhythm. And the patient is having an inferior wall ischemic changes. So now you can see there are too many findings. And if you see the voltage criteria, you can see the left ventricular hypertrophy also. So there are too many changes has happened in this patient. Like that patient will be having, a patient, non-hypertensive patient can have left ventricular hypertrophy, and he may take a beta blocker for hypertension and may develop some junctional arrhythmia or block, and this may present as bradycardia too. So ultimately the ECG may showing is too many findings, clubbed all this together, and you can have to put a clinical diagnosis based on all these together. Yes, this one, again, you have seen this before. History, a 82-year-old man taking beta blocker again, complaining of lightheadedness. That's the history. Yes, anything suggestive?
Sir, left ventricular hypertrophy.
Left ventricular hypertrophy, remember what is the thing I have taught? Left ventricular hypertrophy means you have to add the S in V1 plus the tall R in V6. Where is the tall R in V6? There is no tall R in V6, isn't it? So you have to add these two, then only you get, if it is more than 35 millimeter, that is a diagnostic criteria for LV hypertrophy. This is not LV hypertrophy.
Tall T wave.
Okay, somewhat tall T wave is there, but more than that is a very classical pattern which I have shown you.
Classical pattern.
Sir, a left bundle branch.
Yeah, very good, very good. This is a left bundle branch. Remember that the QRS is widened. The QRS is widened. And the QRS is widened and you have a negative S wave, negative reflection V1 and V2. This is very classical pattern, which I have shown in that LBBB. It's a very classical pattern of left bundle branch block. Okay. So left bundle branch block, the left bundle branch block is an apparent cause for ST elevation. Okay. I have already told that in ST elevation, other cause of ST elevation, the LBBB ECG will look like an ST elevation. That is why you are picking this ST elevation and upright T. That is because of the effect of LBBB. Okay. So LBBB will look like an ST elevation. That's a problem with near assessing an ECG with LBBB. Okay. So LBBB is the correct answer. This again, if you remember, this is the typical RS R dash pattern, QRS widening. Here you can see it more clearly. See an RS R dash pattern, QRS widening, suggestive of right bundle branch block. Okay, this one. Any answers? This you have seen previously. When we were discussing the in the class, you have seen this ECG previously.
Sir, it is irregular, so it is it ectopic beats?
Okay, irregular. Ectopic means a beat should come earlier than what is expected. Okay. Here you have a 2-3 beats and the fourth beat is actually not coming. Ectopic beat means it should come more closer to the previous beat. Then only you consider ectopic beat. So what is this?
So what is this?
So we have answer.
Any answers?
Bundle branch block and double bundle.
Yeah, you can obviously pick up that bundle branch block. Correct. So there is a RSR dash pattern. So there is a right bundle branch block. Correct. But that will not explain the irregularity. Okay. RBBB is a finding, correct? But you will not explain the irregularity. What is the irregularity? What is the rhythm abnormality you are seeing?
What is the rhythm abnormality you are seeing here?
Heart block type 1, Mobitz type.
Mobitz type 1 heart block, yes.
Can you be more specific? Can you be more specific?
Yes, you are almost right. This is the Wenckebach's phenomena. Okay, remember?
Okay.
The PR interval, T1 PR interval, second PR interval, third PR interval, and finally the PR, the QRS is missed. So again, this phenomena repeats. And the QRS is missed. This is very classically a Wenckebach's phenomena or the Mobitz type 1 heart block. First degree is obviously there. Yes, this one. This one also you have seen. It's a rhythm abnormality. 40-year-old woman with palpitation and lightheadedness. The rhythm abnormality. So you just look at the rhythm.
Supraventricular
tachycardia. Yes, correct. It is a supraventricular tachycardia. You can identify by this is a, first of all, you have to identify this as a narrow complex tachycardia. First of all, the rate, look at the rate, it is a tachycardia. Yes, yeah, the complexes, these are all narrow complex. So this is suggestive of a narrow complex tachycardia. So the most common cause of narrow complex tachycardia is supraventricular tachycardia. This you have seen the CCG before. Okay, right. This one, fairly easy. The 57-year-old man with chest pain and sweating.
ST elevation.
Yes.
T3.
This is a yes. ST elevation in the T3 area, suggestive of inferior wall MI, isn't it? And here you have to identify one more thing. Sometimes when the patient comes with inferior wall MI, they will have profound hypotension. So ECG is inferior wall MI, BP is some 70 or 80 systolic. Then what you will do? What is this due to? This is actually due to right ventricular myocardial infarction. Okay. The inferior wall is supplied by the right coronary artery. The right coronary artery, when it is occluded, it produces infarction of the right ventricle as well as the inferior wall. Okay. So the right ventricular MI is characteristically, the cardiac output is produced by the output of right ventricle and the left ventricle. So when the right ventricle is infarcted, it cannot take part in the cardiac output. So the cardiac output is diminished, and as a result, the BP falls down. So this is what happens in hypotension. So whenever you see an inferior wall MI with hypotension, think of right ventricular myocardial infarction. So in that case, you can take a, that will not be reflected in this ECG because you are not taking the right-sided leads. Okay. In that case, you can take a V3R and V4R. Remember that right-sided extra leads. So you are given, take a such an ECG, then ask the technician to take another ECG with V3R and V4R, extra leads based, and you will see an ST elevation V3R and V4R suggestive of a right ventricular myocardial infarction. Okay. In that situation, what you do is give IV fluids. If you give IV fluids, the fluids, if you give rapidly, IV fluids rapidly, the fluid will reach the right side of the heart, and the right ventricle will be distended, and the right ventricle, as it distends more, it will contract more forcefully. This is what you have learned as the Frank-Starling's law. Okay, the stretch of the myocardium myocardial fiber depends the force of contraction. So if you give rapidly IV fluids, the fluid will reach the right side, right ventricle, and the heart will be stretched, and the heart will contract more forcefully. So that's the principle behind giving IV fluids as a treatment for hypotension secondary to right ventricular myocardial infarction, which is commonly seen with inferior wall MI. Okay, right. Okay. And this one, a 74-year-old male with chest pain and palpitation. Again, it's a rhythm abnormality. Anyone? You can look at the lead 2 or V1, which will, I will either give you the answer. Anyone who has given the answer?
No, sir.
It's fairly simple. What you are seeing, Yes, yes, someone has answered. Yes, it is ventricular tachycardia. You are seeing a tachycardia here. The rate is fairly tachycardia. What you are seeing is a broad complex. The QRS is widened. So it is a broad complex tachycardia. You cannot see any P wave. So it's a broad complex tachycardia, monomorphic. So it's a monomorphic ventricular tachycardia. It's a fairly simple question. Okay. This is a QT prolongation. Because of the time concern. And this ECG is showing a fairly rare finding. That is why I included this ECG. What is the ECG finding of an acute pulmonary embolism? Do you know anything? Because pulmonary embolism often comes as a differential diagnosis of myocardial infarction or acute chest pain, all those things, and hypotension, pulmonary embolism can come. Most common finding is a sinus tachycardia. Most common finding you are seeing is a sinus tachycardia. But very rarely you see a finding called S1Q3T3. Have you heard of that? Called S1Q3T3. That I will tell you what it is. This S1 means the S waves. There will be prominent S waves in lead 1. Then Q3 means there will be Q wave in lead 3 and T inversion in lead 3. So S wave in lead 1, that is S1, Q3 and T3. So this is S1Q3T3 pattern. So that is a very rare finding, only seen about 10-15%. So don't depend on this finding to diagnose acute pulmonary embolism. It is very rarely only present. Out of 100 patients, if you take pulmonary embolism, it may be present only in 10%. So it's not that much important, but you have to, sometimes you may encounter this finding, and this is suggestive of acute pulmonary embolism, S1Q3T3. Okay. This again, I will skip because Wolff-Parkinson syndrome is a condition where you have a short PR interval. Okay, short PR interval. And there is a rising pattern. This is called the delta wave. This is something called delta wave is present. Again, not going into the details. You might be learning that later. Say there's an abnormal, you might have learned before because there's an abnormal conducting pathway called the bundle of Kent, through which there is accelerated conduction downwards. And so the PR interval becomes much shortened, and there is a upsloping wave called delta wave here. There is a finding sensitive in Wolff-Parkinson White syndrome. Okay. Again, I'm skipping this, which I have shown previously, the UAs of hypokalemia. Okay, so that ends the topic. So in all ECGs, the there should be something called ECG reporting. Okay, most of the time you will get an ECG, you will not write a report of ECG. That is why you are not you will miss so many findings. So this is actually a format for writing a ECG summary. Okay, here if you take an ECG, you should write what is the rhythm. So whenever you interpret an ECG, you write the report of an ECG. Try to write the report of ECG like you write it as a basic normal sinus rhythm. Heart rate is some 70 or 80. What is the PR interval? How much milliseconds? PR interval, QRS, QT, you calculate. Then you draw the axis and find out the normal axis. Then check for LVBB, RVBB. That's any conduction defects. Any of the bundled branch blocks is present. Check for any right ventricular or left ventricular hypertrophy or right atrial or left atrial enlargement. Check for any myocardial infarction, that's van der Waal or inferior wall, lateral wall, posterior wall, anything else. And check for any miscellaneous effects like hyperkalemia, hypokalemia, hypocalcemia, like that. So if you go that like in that order, you try to report an ECG, you will not miss any of these findings. Otherwise, you may miss directly jump onto an ST elevation MI because that is important, but you may miss a complete heart block, which is underlying. So if you go in this order, you will not miss any important findings of the ECG. So always, whenever you take an ECG, try to write as a report in the case sheet. Like you can write normal sinus rhythm, NSR, heart rate is so and so, PR interval this much milliseconds, QT is this much milliseconds, axis is normal. There is no any. Then you write any specific findings which is present. If you write a report like that for each ECG, then probably you will not miss any of the important findings, and that will give you a good conclusion of the ECG, and you will get a good correlated diagnosis after correlating with the history. Okay. Hope you have I have covered the topic, and if you have any questions, presently I can answer some of them.
So we have one question. Is there any condition where the axis of the ECG cannot be determined?
Yeah, that is possible. That is the one I was talking about, the so-called northwest axis. Okay. You can get I have told the method regarding the lead one and AVF. Suppose both are negative. Lead one is negative, AVF is negative. Then we land up in a situation called the northwest axis. Okay. Here, the problem is that it's an indeterminate, otherwise called the indeterminate axis. You cannot determine the axis. So it is written as axis indeterminate or extreme, northwest axis. So that will not give you any conclusion. So you can get such a situation, but it is very rare.
Okay, so we do not have any more questions from the audience.
Okay. So if it is easy to attend an ECG class and try to learn what are the points, but if you don't practice, the key to learning an ECG is practicing. Okay. So as long as you are not practicing, you tend to forget what you have learned. Okay. So the key to understand or you get yourself a master in ECG is by looking onto the ECGs very frequently. So if it is not available, you can utilize ECG quizzes which are available in the internet, or fairly if you have patients, then fairly you can check for the patient's ECG. Like that, you try to interpret yourself different type of ECG correlating with the clinical history. Like what we have done in the last session of this topic, you have numerous ECGs and you have numerous clinical scenarios, and you try to correlate between these two, and then the thing will come into your mind, and as you have done different numerous ECGs, your skill goes up, and automatically you will identify more and more things in the ECG much fairly. What I have just described is only the basics, because if you want to enter into the sea of ECG, there are numerous things to learn further, but only after learning the basics of ECG you can proceed into that level. Okay, so if you don't have doubts or questions, you try to interpret more and more ECGs based on the whatever you have learned in this topic. And as you are looking more and more deep into the ECGs, you will get numerous questions or numerous queries regarding that. And I will be happy to answer if you bring up any questions to me. Thank you.
Sir, we have one more question.
Yes, yes.
Any other things that we need to keep in mind in case of dextrocardia?
Okay, right. Dextrocardia I have actually purposefully avoided because it's a very rare situation. Actually, dextrocardia, we will talk when it comes to something like a limb reversal. Remember that lead reversal, accidentally lead reversing. Suppose the right arm and left arm leads are misplaced. So imagine the lead which should be kept in the right arm by the ECG technician. Accidentally, ECG technician has put on the left arm. And similarly, the right and left got interchanged. Then the ECG will look something like a dextrocardia. So dextrocardia means the heart is has rotated to the opposite side, isn't it? So the normal, the patient, it will be looking, there will be changes according to that. Okay. So there are two situations where you get confused. Either it's a limb reversal or it's a dextrocardia. But dextrocardia will show a characteristic R, progressive R-wave progression. Remember the R-wave progression I have discussed, that from V1 to V6, the R-wave will be progressing. Okay. But in case of a limb lead reversal, this will not happen. It's slightly complicated, but the problem is that imagine the vector direction is totally towards the opposite side. We are placing the chest leads in thinking that it is a normal heart, but unfortunately the heart's polarity towards the opposite side. So that will produce changes. The AVR will be not like a typical AVR. Okay, AVR will be usually all waves of AVR will be negative, but extracard will be not like that. But actually slightly more complicated, requires more a sitting session to discuss that. But extracardia, you should identify remember that AVR is not showing the typical negativity, and the lead one is not showing the typical positivity. If such findings are there, then one possibility you have to think is either limb lead reversal or it may be dextrocardia. So that you have to clinically correlate by checking the apex beat as well as taking a chest x-ray.
Okay, sir, there are no more questions. I think we can wind up.
Okay, right. Thank you for your listening. Hope I have shed some light into the field of ECG. So you try, yeah. Practice more and more, and you will be becoming more and more expert as you practice more and more. Thank you.
Okay, we thank you, sir, for taking such a valuable lecture for us. Okay. And I express our sincere gratitude on behalf of